Good afternoon. I'm so glad to be invited to this family affair. All graduations are really family events. The family of your faculty and staff members and fellow students, and most important, the families that got you this far. And so let me just say a few words to your families, especially those members of your families who are not public health professionals. Yes, in fact, it is a difficult thing to explain to many Americans what exactly is public health. To me, public health is everything. There is nothing that happens in this nation, nothing that you do from the moment you wake up to the moment you fall asleep at night, that is not part and parcel of public health. We are an interdisciplinary field. And among the graduates today are public health educators, lawyers and epidemiologists, historians and statisticians, health managers and nurses and engineers and physicians and psychologists, and you can go on and on and on. Some of the graduates today came to us as young people seeking to improve the world. Many came to this school as mature professionals, still committed to changing the world. Another thing that families wonder about, they may not say it today, but they are thinking this, is what about jobs? What about status? Is my investment in this student going to pay off ever? Some of these graduates already work in public health. Some of them work in governmental public health. And those people and their families know the trials and tribulations of government workers. This is a difficult time for our nation, and many of them, like so many of my fellow workers in local public health departments, some 18,000 of them in the past year, understand cutbacks and layoffs and furlough days. In fact, let me announce here publicly for Fox News, I am on a furlough day. But those of us in governmental public health are really privileged to work closely with the people we serve in the communities that we live in. The programs that we run in local health departments and state health departments, the surveillance we maintain, the decisions we make impact the lives of people in their communities every single day. Most of the graduates will find themselves outside of government. Some will actually go on and still be students next year. And that's a good thing, parents. Don't despair, that's a good thing. Some will join institutions as researchers and faculty members. Most of them will find their way into a wide variety of organizations and roles. And many of those organizations they work for will not even realize that they're public health organizations. Ours is a field that's woven into the soul of this country. It was 150 years ago this year that the American Civil War began, an event that may sound like a dry, boring fact, but it is an event that led to the abolition of slavery in this country, a dry historical fact that I take personally. 125 years ago this year in Chicago, the Haymarket demonstrations occurred. And that demonstration and police riot, which resulted in workers of unions being hung in trials later, contributed probably more to improving the health of Americans than any other single event because it fought for the 8-hour workday. It's been 100 years since just a short distance from this building the Triangle Shirtwaist Fire occurred, where over 100, mostly immigrants, mostly women, died because the bosses locked them in the factories. Lessons from history are real. It's only a few years ago that we took Walmart to court for locking their workers in on the third shift. There's a saying in public health, made famous by another institution, that when public health works, we're invisible. refuse to be invisible. Refuse to be invisible because we were able to double the life expectancy of this nation between 1850 and 1950. It didn't happen by public health staying invisible. If you look at CDC's 10 greatest public health achievements, that didn't happen by us being invisible. The decrease in morbidity and mortality for occupational diseases didn't happen because of cohort studies. They happened because public health people joined with workers of this country to fight for workers' rights and to change the way work takes place in this country. When we pat ourselves on the back for healthier foods and safer water, that didn't happen because of only what went on in the bench research. It happened because we were part of social movements that fought to make the food healthy and safe. The improvement in women and children's health didn't happen because women and children are nice. It happened because it was part and parcel of social movements over decades to eliminate slums, to make sure that we could clean up the running sewage in our cities, and to join in what seems to be a never-ending fight to make sure that women in this country have the right to control ourselves and our bodies. Refuse to be invisible. We need to lend our strength and our science to broad social movements whose goal it is to make things better. That's what it means to improve the health of the people. In recent decades, public health has forgotten too often its history. We have focused on how little we're appreciated, how few resources we have. We talk about networking with the broad community. And when that becomes an excuse for not fighting the cutbacks, we do ourselves and our field a disservice. There is no question that the cutbacks in public health in the past 30 years and the cutbacks that are going on right now as we speak destroy the seed stock of our field. Refuse to be invisible. I reject the notion coming out of Atlanta lately that we can only focus on the winnable battles, battles that we can make measurable progress on in 4 years. That's not how we improve the health of the nation. Dare to think about the real issues, the real problems, however complicated they are. Refuse to be forced into a narrow technocratic response to one health problem or another. This nation has just experienced a worldwide pandemic for flu, H1N1, remember that? Now we lucked out there, everybody. We were really lucky. But what did we do in public health? Cover your cough, wash your hands, and if you're sick, stay home, right? And if you were a progressive health department, you did it in 30 languages. Where was the real public health message there? How do we expect people to stay home from work when they don't have sick days? A real preparation for a flu pandemic would be to legislate that every worker in this country have protected sick days, paid sick days. We know what we're supposed to do. We know that the health of people is determined by, not influenced by, not colored, determined by the social conditions in which we live. This is why social, political, economic inequalities lead directly to health inequities. Ours is a field that encompasses both an individual focus, which clinical medicine often claims as its own, and a population focus. But as a physician who is trained in public health, I'm here to tell you that these are two sides of the same coin, that you can't have one without the other, that it's critical in public health to understand how individuals think and work and make decisions, just as it's critical for my clinical colleagues to understand what makes communities and populations healthy. And they're not always exactly the same. Individual decisions and work is important. but we also have to address broader issues. Jobs, safe, secure, well-paid jobs with dignity. That is the first brick that you need for a healthy community and a healthy nation. Still today, 14 workers go to work every day and die on the job. What happens to a community when 20, 30, or 40% of its young men have never worked? Welcome to my block. The question of jobs and economy impacts all of us. We live in a nation where the growing gap in wealth is the worst that it's been since 1920. We have the same level of inequity as China. From the end of World War II through the 1970s, we saw a different period of history. The gaps narrowed, the health inequalities narrowed, the poor actually got richer. But starting in the late 70s, we've seen a widening of those inequities. And so for the past 26 years, the bottom fifth of our population's income has increased by about $8 a year, $200 over 26 years. The top one-tenth of 1% saw its income grow by some $6 million. We live in a nation where the top 5% of the households account for 63% of the wealth, and the bottom 80% accounts for only 13% of the wealth. Jobs, income and wealth, housing in neighborhoods, it's not just that housing can exacerbate asthma or that the built environment can interfere with a healthy lifestyle. Housing is a major mechanism of wealth accumulation in the United States, and this recent and still continuing foreclosure crisis has wiped out more family wealth among Blacks and Latinos than anything else in our history. You're here today getting degrees, and if I could change just one sector of our society, it would be education. The people in this country who build prisons know how many cells to build based on how many third graders can't read. This is probably the greatest violence we do against our youth, failing to teach them how to read. In some communities in Chicago, it's been estimated that for every 100 Black boys that start kindergarten, only 3 will receive a bachelor's degree by the age of 25. Where is our voice as public health professionals that says when they cut the education budget, you will kill more people? When they increase the class size to 45, you will create more smokers. You will increase obesity. You will have more diabetics. People will get sicker and they will die younger. That is what we need to be saying. Public health knows that a sustainable food system is critical to the health of the country. Actually, the largest single public health legislation that Congress looks at every year is the agricultural bill. And that's what we should be teaching in our policy classes, not simply how the CDC is funded. And let me remind you, even though we are often posed in opposition to medical care, that medical care is a social determinant of health. Who gets medical care, when they get it, and what kind they get is determined by social and political conditions. And we live in a country that has passed a major piece of legislation last year, but still, 22 million Americans, if everything works perfectly, will remain uninsured. And if you're an immigrant without documents, even though we hire you to work in our homes and businesses, even though you'll pay taxes, even though you continue as previous immigrants have done to enrich our nation, you will be prohibited from participating in this great medical reform. We cannot have a healthcare system that refuses to cover people that are here without documents. We live in a nation with a broken medical care system. And as a physician, I will tell you quite simply and plainly, we need to start to fix it by adopting a single-payer system for financing. So how did this come to pass? How did we end up here? One of the real historical contributions that we as a nation has made to the world is our understanding and value that we put on it, the individual. This is very different than many old cultures in Europe and many cultures elsewhere in the world, where the emphasis is always on the group. And I want to value and call out that important contribution. But there's a belief sweeping our land. It's almost like a mythology that's spreading out like bad air, that raises this notion of the individual to the level of an icon. It's almost like a religion, as though the only way America survived was by the individual. There are no individual frontiersmen. They died. Americans don't really believe that when you really ask them. On the banks of the Mississippi, they're not sitting there as individuals. They're coming together in communities and churches and families, sandbagging and trying to make sure that the old and the young are taken care of. Americans are peculiar. We all believe that we're all middle class, and we all have faith that we're going to win the lottery. And mailman graduates know that that's statistically impossible. But it's this magical thinking that says, I'm an individual. All I need is me, my husband, and my kids. We can face the world. This magical thinking that says government is useless, collective action is futile, and it logically follows then that public health is useless. This notion that we try to brainwash the population, don't try to solve that problem. It's too complicated. It's too big. It's too expensive. We've retreated public health professionals from our core mission, keeping people healthy, to safer areas. Vital records, communicable disease registries, laboratory services, environmental chemistry, categorical medical care, where the medical system doesn't want to be bothered. We have a paternalistic component to our history. We issue commandments from the pulpit. Eat 5 fruits and vegetables a day. Brush your teeth. Don't smoke. We effectively cut ourselves off from our base of support. During my youth in the 60s, a period when there was great social upheaval and progress was made, the poor got richer, the ignorant were educated, and the gaps between Americans were narrower. Our cry was, what do you want? Freedom. When do you want it? Now. Not what do you want? Evidence-based interventions. When do you want it? After peer review. Public health is synonymous with social justice, and we need leadership from you. Social justice and public health argue that collectively, through our planned collective action, we can change things that are wrong. We can make things right and improve people's health. By tying ourselves and our careers to social justice movements of today, we can make progress like we have in past decades. You know what needs to be done. You know that medical care is not going to improve the health of people by itself, and that the social and political circumstances really determine how far we're able to go. You understand that every policy that we have in this country is a policy about health. You know that in order to really make progress, we have to improve the daily conditions that people live in, the circumstances in which people are born, grow, live, work, and age. That means supporting the rights of workers to organize and fighting for basic democracy. You know that only by tackling an equitable distribution of power, money, and resources can we really address the things that divide Americans: class, gender, racism. And you know, because you're good graduates of this school, that we have to measure, understand, study, and survey the problem and the interventions that we put in place, the policy changes we make, to make sure that we're going in the right direction. Graduates, we need you to join us, because you know in your hearts that it's just not right that your life expectancy be determined by the class of your parents, or where you work, or how much money you make. It's never been right that your survival from high blood pressure or diabetes or cancer be determined by the color of your skin or the gender that you have. We must stand up as public health professionals and fight against the diseases plaguing our nation. Racism, war against workers, hatred, bigotry, foreign wars. The Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King said, "Rarely do we find men willing to engage in hard, solid thinking. There is almost a universal quest for easy answers and half-baked solutions. Nothing pains some people more than having to think." Graduates, you know how to think. You know what must be done. Refuse to be invisible. Join us, and let's just do it. Thank you.